A very good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have apologies from Katie Clark. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda item 3 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So our next agenda item is an evidence session on the pension age disability payment ahead of our consideration of the Disability Assistance for Older People Scotland Regulations 2024 next week. And I welcome to the meeting Debbie Horn, Scotland Policy and Public Affairs Manager, Independent Age, and Adam Statura, Associate Director for Policy, Communications and External Affairs, Age Scotland, who are joining us in the room. And Marlon Howard, Member, Scottish Commission on Social Security, who is joining us remotely. So thank you all for accepting our invitation. And just a few points about the format of the meeting before we start. So if you could please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. For Marlon online, please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. And you can indicate with an R in the chat box in Zoom if you wish to come in on a question. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? So we'll get on and move on to the questions. And the first question is on the theme of social security principles. And I'm going to direct that to Marlon first of all. And if you could just maybe outline in what ways do the aims and language of the attendance allowance sit uneasily alongside the social security principles?
Thank you very much for inviting me today. Before I answer that question specifically, I wonder if it might be helpful just to mention the role of the Scottish Commission on Social Security. We provide independent scrutiny of the Scottish Social Security system, and our specific functions are to scrutinise draft regulations through the lens of the Social Security principles, to report on any matter when requested to do so by Scottish ministers or the Scottish Parliament, and to report on the extent to which any of the expectations in the Social Security Charter are being met. So to inform our scrutiny, we regularly engage with stakeholders, and we're very grateful to those who assisted us with the scrutiny of the pension age disability payment. More specifically on the aims and language of attendance allowance, we noted that this was introduced at a very different time and context to now. Attendance allowance was introduced in the 1970s. And when that was the case, the name itself hasn't changed for almost that period of time. And the Social Security principles were not in place at that time. That's only come about through devolved social security. So when we talk to stakeholders about attendance allowance and pension age disability payment, they told us that in aligning with attendance allowance, the aims of the pension age disability payment tend to emphasise needs for personal care, whereas benefits for people of working age tend to be seen as a contribution to extra disability-related costs, which also includes help with mobility needs. Mm-hmm. The language and the name of attendance allowance, they told us, can also be confusing because it can imply that it's either a payment to the carer or it had to be used for care specifically. So we, in the report, we refer to the rationale of aligning the aims to facilitate a safe and secure case transfer, but also in the longer term, we recommended that the Scottish Government review pension age disability payment for consistency with the principles, and this recommendation was accepted by the Government.
OK, that's really helpful, Marilyn. I don't know if Adam or Debbie would like to come in on that. No? OK, I'll move on. And the next theme is the mobility component, and I'm going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think this is an area that there's been some debate around. And so my question really is, to what extent has the Scottish Government provided a reasonable justification for not introducing a mobility component? And perhaps I'd especially emphasise that they've said that the cost would be quite significant, so maybe you could touch on that. Ms Horne, do you want to start?
Yes. Yes, I can. Thank you. And thank you for the opportunity to give evidence here today. So at independent age, we do believe that a pension age disability payment should contain a mobility component. We understand the logic for the safe and secure transition and can see why at this stage and at creation of pension age disability payment, it does not contain that mobility component. But we believe that going forward, we should be ambitious and really aspire to make sure that older people can access a mobility component within pension age disability payment. We know that being able to participate in society is a kind of fundamental right for older people, and also that disabled people have the right to kind of independent living. And the evidence and the need that we hear from older people when it comes to the mobility component is really, really clear. So when we surveyed older people back in December last year, an overwhelming majority of them supported the introduction of a mobility component. We heard from one older lady who told us that she had just missed out on the mobility component, as she'd claimed attendance allowance was just over state pension age, and she was actually using some of the money she was receiving from attendance allowance to kind of put by, because she recognised at some point in the future she would need extra mobility aids and a potentially mobility scooter. So we see that clear need there from older people. We also know from the survey that we did that around 75% of older people that have a long-term health condition or a disability do face increased costs, and also that it makes it harder for them to get out of the house and to meet friends and family. So whilst we do appreciate the importance of the safe and secure transition, we do believe that longer term there should be a review of pension age disability payment looking specifically at that mobility component. The cost is obviously a key barrier there, and we've seen that the Scottish Government's kind of estimated figures. But what I would say is that we really need to look at this as an investment in people, in line with the social security principles, that social security is an investment in the people of Scotland and it allows people to flourish. And we know that there is really clear evidence there that investing in the people of Scotland through a mobility component would enable kind of reduced preventative spend eventually. So when you look at things like health and social care, the impact on isolation and loneliness, the knock-on effects that introducing a mobility component would result in savings further down the line for the Scottish Government.
I mean, can I just press you on that? Because,
yes.
I mean, we'd have to find the money now.
Yes.
And maybe the savings come along in a few years.
Yes.
But it's this year's budget we'd have to be looking at. Would you have any suggestions as to where, I mean, we've been suggested 580 million might be on the low side. Would you have any suggestions where should that come from? Should we raise taxes, cut the Scottish Child Payment, or what should we do?
Yes, so that would be a decision for the Scottish Government.
Are you not rather ducking out of that? To prioritise
their budget and where they want to spend. If the Scottish Government, its commitment to human rights budgeting, we should be looking at budgeting through that framework. So we wouldn't suggest cuts in other areas. We would leave that decision for the Scottish Government.
If you wouldn't suggest cuts, then you would suggest tax increases?
No, I'm saying it's up for the Scottish Government to manage their budget and to decide. At independent age, we will always advocate in the best interests of older people in poverty and for what they need. When it comes to budgetary decisions, I will leave that to the Scottish Government.
OK, Mr Sakura, do you want to come in?
Your first point or first question around the kind of justification, I think this has been a long-running conversation that organisations that deal with and work with people who require or should need social security support have been looking at for a while. It's right that Marilyn Howard's saying that this was brought in 1970. That was the same year as the Beatles disbanded, Apollo 13. You know, it's a long time. We're looking at 54 years since this started, and actually while we've got in this position just now where we're trying to have this kind of safe and secure transition, the government have said that it's not something to look at for the foreseeable future, which is quite disappointing actually, to even consider it, because the only justification is, well, I'm not saying it's not insignificant, the only justification is on the cost grounds. Back at the end of last year, we had met with officials from the Scottish Government, the relevant officials here, who, you know, I think, quite frankly, were open and understood the rationale that why it almost is essentially ageist. You've picked a date upon which somebody will either receive extra support and one which you won't, and that line is the state pension age. We met with the Cabinet Secretary at the end of March and had a very similar conversation, looked at some of the proposals that we had put forward, which I think are part of your papers anyway, and I think there was certainly an acceptance that there is something more that can be done. But the point around this, I think, is the justification is solely on the cost grounds. And to your second question, Mr. Mason, that, you know, where would you kind of cut? It's really difficult, because actually in different inquiries that the Parliament has looked at when it's trying to scrutinise, particularly pre-budget scrutiny of Scottish Government budgets, it's actually quite hard to go into the granular detail of what's been spent where. I'm not suggesting that it'd be easy to find £500 million if that is what it was, but there are also, I suspect, kind of tiers of spend on this. If you're maybe it wouldn't be mirroring exactly what you'd get under, say, currently PIP, which would come with you if you are over state pension age, which is, I think, part of this challenge here, is that if you have applied at a certain point for this kind of Social Security or disability benefit and you receive a mobility component, let's call it at 65, but at 67, you're not going to get it. There's not much change in your life in those 2 years. And of course, that's maybe the extreme end of the argument, with such a close line, this kind of line that has been decided by government, where it's going to be relevant or not. But the persons need their mobility, need their need for independence and participation, and just need their kind of own self-worth, their ability to kind of preventing further health challenges and conditions is something which kind of added mobility can certainly help with. It adds to levels of loneliness and isolation, which is an incredible cost on our health service as well.
Would there be an issue as to exactly what the money was going to be used for? Because, I mean, a buggy I see as a very positive thing that gets people to the shops and, you know, up and down the road, that kind of thing, as compared to a car, which most of us now see as not a good thing, you know, because we want to reduce the number of cars. Is that a factor?
I think it sort of depends where you live as well. You know, the buggy might be helpful if you're living in, say, central Edinburgh, or maybe not, because of I'm saying this slightly facetiously, if you want to navigate potholes or high curbs. We're not exactly in a position in Scotland where we've got a kind of age-friendly or kind of disability-friendly kind of design of our communities. But there will be occasions if somebody is able to use that, of course. But the cars as well might be a necessity for people. Some people, if they're receiving attendance allowance just now and future PADP, might already have their own car, but actually support to have it adapted might be the level. Not necessarily having to have a, you know, off the forecourt motability car, but how can you have suitable adaptations made? So the point about the kind of the full amount of money might not be the case, that there could be tiers in, that somebody needs that little bit of support, but in actual fact that attendance allowance money on its own wouldn't cover that, because we still in a position where, you know, about half of, and I said this, apologies for the repetition a few days ago, but about half of pensioners in Scotland are either living in poverty or very, very low income, that their reliance on the state pension is incredible, and the state pension that they're receiving isn't necessarily the higher rate. If you're in your 70s anyway, you're receiving that lower rate, not the £12,000 a year, but some about £9,500 a year, and the attendance allowance at a higher rate of £100-odd a week doesn't quite cut it. So, and if you're considering that link with poverty and disability as well, all these factors come into play. But there are, I certainly think, you know, your point about the car maybe not being recognised as a good thing, but for some people it will be essential.
Yeah, no, I get that. So I'll maybe bring in Ms Howard. Do you want to say anything on this?
Yes, please. I wonder if it's helpful to add that in our scrutiny report, obviously the issue of mobility was very important. And our report contained an observation that justifications for not introducing a mobility component and any mitigations could be explored by the government within the framework of an updated equality impact assessment. So officials engaged positively with us on this issue, And we were pleased to see that comments that the board had made on mobility and the equality impact assessment were taken on board in the updated version, with more in-depth sections on both justifications and mitigations. And finally, to say that, yes, this is tricky because it involves a balance between different social security principles. For example, continuously improving the social security system with the needs of those who require assistance in mind and to advance equality, but also thinking about value for money and efficiency. So it's a tricky trade-off to be making.
Is that your final word? Is it tricky? You don't say you're satisfied or dissatisfied, just it's tricky.
Well, it's not the role of the Scottish Commission on Social Security to make policy decisions, but we actually look at the principles to understand the impact of particular decisions that lie behind draft regulations and use that as a mechanism to raise issues with officials and ministers, but it's for ministers to make decisions.
OK, thanks so much. Thanks, Convener.
OK, before I bring in Jeremy Balfour, I believe Bob Doris would like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. I was struck by Debbie Horn's comments about human rights-based budgeting, and I get the point that Debbie's making. I chair a committee on rare and genetic conditions in this Parliament and also in palliative end-of-life care. Demands of budgets are such, Convener, that they would also demand human rights budgeting to meet their expectations that their human rights are met. So I appreciate Ms Horn saying, but it can be quite simplistic sometimes to look at it that way. So if I look at it simply from a budgeting point of view, £580 million is clearly eye-watering and simply not affordable, even though it would be a really positive thing to do. If there was £20 million available to improve the lives of older people, how would Ms Horn or Mr Sakura spend it? Because that would bring to life how we prioritise budgets in this place.
Yes, thank you for the question. I think when we look in Scotland at older people, we've got around 150,000 pensioners who are in poverty. So if we were looking at what could £20 million do for those older people, it's obviously a huge amount. In terms of what the Scottish Government should be prioritising, independent age is clear kind of recommendations, a key one being a pensioner poverty strategy that could be could go alongside kind of budget commitments for actions in that pensioner poverty strategy. So I'll give you one example. We know that take-up is an issue for older people with regards to social security. So currently at the minute, only around 63% of older people in Great Britain receive the pension credit they're entitled to. And we've done research that shows that if you were to increase uptake in Scotland to 100% for older people, overnight you would lift 38,000 older people out of poverty. So that isn't even additional spend, that is just getting those people the money they're entitled to. And we've done various work looking at different initiatives that local authorities, for example, have done by gathering data. So that money could be spent for really targeted take-up action across all social security for older people, and that would have a noticeable and significant impact on the lives of older people in poverty in Scotland immediately, effectively.
I wanted that on the record, the art of the achievable rather than the aspirations, and we're very well intentioned. I totally get why you want the mobility component, Ms Horn. Mr Sakura, what would your priority be?
I mean, very similar things. But if you look at the £20 million, might seem like a lot of money, but it's also not a lot of money. And you said the art of the possible, Ms Doris, I was feeling that is that the art of the possible, or is that the ceiling of the possible? If you even look at the number of people saying that haven't received an attendance allowance today, about 130,000 in Scotland, what does that additional, maybe if it was so focused, it's not very much. I do think your point, I'm trying not to be facetious with this, but it certainly, there's more actions we certainly think the Scottish Government can take to kind of raise incomes of people to, you know, there's about £500 million in Scotland that goes unclaimed by older people in the social security they're entitled to, whether that is not just as Debbie said on the council, pension credit, but the associated council tax reduction, housing benefit, tenants allowance and other things. So the money's sit somewhere. So the idea of using money to better target, to better try and drive up uptake is ideal. What I suggest, though, if you're looking at trying to spend some money here, and what else you could do in mobility components, and whether this is for further questions, is actually looking at, you know, whether there was funds so people could access adaptations for vehicles, whether we've got something we'd like to see, which I think is very simple to do, in a simplistic sense, is that how we might manage to use Social Security Scotland to better link up the need for a blue badge, so that people, once they've applied for PADP and they've been, you know, proved that have a disability or disabled, and that and the kind of eligibility there, that why isn't that just passported?
Okay.
Why do you have another application for? Could the cost of that be kind of assumed through that? So there are things you can do, but it's quite hard on a base of number. The need is massive, and the fuel poverty now, four in ten older people are living in fuel poverty in Scotland.
Really helpful from both witnesses. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to you all. Thanks for coming today. Obviously, we do mitigate some costs already for older people. We've got free bus travel, we've got free personal care, and although not financial, you have a blue badge scheme, as you just mentioned. I mean, presumably you don't want to get rid of any of those, but are those not mitigations of why maybe the mobility component is not within attendance allowance or the new benefit?
That might have been a justification from governments that, yes, you've got a pass, but can you use it? And this goes back to my point from Mr Mason's question about where you live in the country. Are the buses accessible? Do they go where you need them to go? What other support do you require? And just having that in itself is it meant to be as an entitlement as well. It's not just a here you go and now often be quiet about this. You've got a free bus pass. You know, and it's also an opt-in thing for people to get. Of course, you've got an entitlement. Many people will opt in, but depending what that line of need is for such a thing, and of course it's not as simple as this, but you know it costs as much as it's used, but we know from lots of other research and bus passes, for instance, that they are underused in lots of parts of the country, that the routes that are being cut, particularly maybe to John Mason's point earlier on about the cars maybe not being deemed by some as the best thing to do, but when you look at rural bus travel and routes being cut as being financially unsustainable, that bus pass is worth nothing unless you get a car into an urban area and you can get a bus somewhere or get the park and ride in somewhere or whatever. So I think there's a difference between what is available on paper and then the reality of that. And it's also similar to the arguments around if you're an older carer, okay, you've got a pension, that's enough, your entitlement. You might have worked 40 or 50 years to receive, quite frankly, a very low and modest amount of money from the state. But is that enough to say, okay, you're not entitled to as an unpaid carer to any extra support, the costs that you incur, and the fact you might be caring for someone for a long period of time and that your household income might have been substantially impacted. So I think there are things which are very good about having it in Scotland, but maybe not just seen as, well, you've got this and that's enough. If that is a ceiling of aspiration, then essentially what's the point of the Scottish Parliament? What's the point of devolution? We might be doing different things, which, as we've done with, you know, changing different regimes around how social care operates in Scotland compared to other parts of the UK. Like, there's big opportunity to look at things differently and not just say, right, it's quite expensive, we're not going to look at it again. So if at first you don't succeed, we try and try again.
OK, well, can I just develop that a wee bit with maybe Ms Holland as well? That, as you said, you don't want this immediately, so this is a... You want everyone to get transferred across safely and then for Tlaica again. And obviously, I know Aid Scotland have had discussions with Scottish Government. I know that you've put alternatives forward. So do we need to redesign the system completely? So rather than just giving a lump sum of money, do we need to look at a more individually scheme? Is that practical? So if you live in a rural area, your need might be very different if you live in central Glasgow. Do we need, or as Mr Mason has said, maybe a buggy is more appropriate than a car. Do we need some kind of scheme, and I appreciate it would be very difficult maybe to come up with, which is more flexible, rather than just saying, here's a lump sum of money, looking at what that individual needs, and is that possible in reality?
Yes, it's a good question. I think at independent age, and a lot of the research around how kind of money is best used to tackle poverty, and obviously we know a high number of disabled people do live in poverty, is the cash-first approach. So in terms of getting rid of the money element. That is really important, that people have that cash first, that they can have the kind of choice over what they spend the money on, which will best kind of improve their life and support their needs. The wider point about do we need to kind of look at the system, I think links back to the point Marilyn was making earlier around when attendance allowance was designed, the time it was designed in, compared to now, the way that the social security principles and that human rights approach. So do we need that wider review? And I do know that the Scottish Campaign on Rights to Social Security many years ago published their long-term vision, kind of beyond a safe and secure transition report. And that was the report that originally contained the recommendation for a review of disability payments in Scotland. The Scottish Government have taken forward that recommendation with regards to adult disability payment, and we have the independent review there. But there is definitely a case, do we need to relook at pension age disability payment? And it's one of the recommendations at independent age support that was made by Age Scotland, is around that review within sort of 2 years after full rollout, to look at the system, how is it operating, how is it meeting the needs of older people, what improvements can be made and what changes can be made and what is feasible. So we would kind of recommend that there is that longer term relook at the system and how it supports people.
I mean, so Tebby answered a lot of that there actually, but I think the this isn't always just about redesigning everything from scratch, because there's lots of elements of attendance allowance which are very positive, not least it's not means tested. That the assumption then that, you know, people might have income, but your costs can be very variable. I'm sure everyone in this chamber, the MSPs have the same income, broadly speaking, but your lives are very different and how you spend the money is different. And that's the same for everyone outside this room. And you're thinking about people who are receiving attendance allowance and what they might use that for. In the 1 week, it might be physiotherapy, paid privately because they can't possibly get that anywhere near the NHS because the waiting lists are too long, or actually they're never going to be referred because they're seen as being too old to benefit from this kind of subtle ageism. We know it does exist in our public services. Another week, some of that money might be helped with, you know, cleaning the house because they can't do so themselves, or for cooking meals. And the idea that money is, in its modest amount of money, we're not exactly looking at people who are having a decadent lifestyle with that spend. But I think there's more about this for us, almost kind of slightly kind of selfish for people who require this, is like, how can we enhance this, as opposed to saying, this is our ceiling, this is what we've got, this is all we're going to go and do. And I think the danger can be that blank sheet of paper, because I think part of what we have here is, do you create a bureaucracy to assess and identify what somebody needs? And actually, who is that person that's making that decision? What right does somebody have to kind of appeal against that? You know, and their access to different schemes. I think part of this is, could you open up the doors to other things? Could you open up the doors to motability? Could you open up the doors to cheaper rates for mobility scooters? You know, do things have to cost as much as they do in this current environment? So I think there's kind of more in terms of how you enhance in the future, but very much looking at what we've done in 2 years and how effective that's been. You know, have we seen an increase in people claiming PADP compared to attendance allowance? Because is the system through Social Security better than it is through DWP? Do you have to fill in a 30-page application form and then feel that actually I'm trying to, you're not going to it saying I'm painting myself in the worst light, because that's really what they're looking for in that assessment. You're honest about that day, you might feel a bit better, and actually, how do you feel today? So I think there's a lot more in this. It's maybe not answering your question perfectly, Mr. Balfour, but I think it's certainly about how we can review, but also to enhance, and not assuming what has been handed to Scotland in a sense from what the UK government have had is the best it can be, but there are certainly great elements within that in terms of flexibility and differing needs wherever you are in the country, which are very, very important.
Thank you, Camilla.
Now, just, I'm conscious of the time as well. So, I've still quite a lot to get through at the moment. So, if everyone could keep their questions and answers as concise as possible. So, moving on to theme three, differences from attendance allowance, I'm going to invite Paul O'Kane in. Thanks.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. And I suppose perhaps building on some of the discussion we've had so far, I think we are keen as a committee to understand the ways in which PADP will differ from attendance allowance. I think particularly in terms of the experience for people applying and going through that process. And I think, as I say, we'd already begun to perhaps touch on some of those experiences. So I don't know if Mr. Stukura wants to maybe continue in terms of the experience, and then we'll hear from others.
Thanks. I will be brief, though, convener. I think there's the aspiration around for people who will then experience Social Security Scotland has always been that it would be a more straightforward experience they might have had through DWP. That there are certainly lots of principles behind how Social Security Scotland work, which would make it more accessible for people, more support to kind of to apply and to claim and to have, you know, a bit more flexibility in where they how they can do so. That's certainly an aspirational thing. I think the kind of well, this will be quite tricky because there'll be a lot of people compared to what previous sort of older people's benefits have come to Scotland thus far, there'll be a lot of people kind of moving over. I know it's kind of it's going to be phased. We'll have the first few local authorities doing so at the end of this year, and then more next year. Slightly worried about being able to handle well 130,000 people kind of moving over, and then every new claim therein, and sort of there's been kind of lofty aspirations, I think, in terms of how we'll deal and cope with the devolution, and have not necessarily always been as straightforward as that, whether it's been long waiting times for applications being processed, whether it's been, you know, maybe slightly subpar communications to people, and maybe underestimating the demand for something as soon as it's open. For instance, with certain the benefits with regard to carers or children, that once these things are opened up, even through text messages, that systems are overloaded. But actually, we sort of would expect that to happen, but maybe not set up to deal with it. So I think in terms of your question, Mr. King, is the hope is certainly there that it can be more straightforward, but we need more than just that. The reality and understanding what's been going on just now and how we've been able to process and manage Social Security in Scotland is got to be live and incredibly important how to take over this one and for future benefits as well, not least the devolution of winter fuel payment as well at the end of this year. So we're looking at hundreds of thousands of more people, not millions, who are going to be receiving payments through Social Security Scotland.
Does Ms Horne have anything to add?
Yes, thank you, Mr O'Kane. So I will be brief, but just to add to what Adam said, we are hopeful as well that the system will result in a better experience for older people in Scotland, so that the commitment of Social Security Scotland to treat people with dignity, fairness and respect, it's so important to reduce the stigma around claiming Social Security that we particularly see amongst older people. That language being incredibly important as well in terms of the client experience, so ensuring that things are said in an accessible and plain English way for people. And also the choice of application route, we think will be a really positive difference. So the ability to have home visits, for example, through the local delivery offices at Social Security Scotland. We see older people who, around 6% actually in our survey, who were disabled living with a long-term condition, who had not applied for attendance allowance because they did not have the support to apply. And as Adam's mentioned, it's a very complicated 30-page form. So the experience in terms of having that local delivery office, being able to get a home visit, should hopefully improve that experience of applying for pension age disability payment for older people. And in terms of the changes from attendance allowance, we do welcome the change around reduction of the past presence test, and also the changes around terminal illness and how they will help can improve access and that experience for people who are in a really awful position having to apply for Social Security after receiving that diagnosis.
Okay, thank you. And I wonder if I might turn to SCOS now. And one of the differences in provision is short-term assistance, obviously, and SCOS have said that they do have concerns about its interaction with other benefits. So I wonder if those concerns remain or whether interaction with government has changed that position, Marilyn.
Thank you. Yes, short-term assistance, as people will know, is a payment for people just in Scotland who are challenging a decision to reduce or stop their disability assistance until their entitlement is decided. So it's something which is not available from DWP. And our report stated that whilst that can be a very helpful way to encourage people to challenge a decision. We were concerned that there might be financial detriment for some people who receive short-term assistance, who win their award again, but actually lose a passported benefit from the reserved system run by DWP, because short-term assistance is technically not a qualifying benefit. And the technical issue there is that benefits from the reserve system are normally payable if pension age disability payment would be actually paid, not where someone is entitled but not paid. So although any pension age disability payment can be backdated, it only becomes a qualifying benefit technically when it's actually paid. So in our report, we gave an example of a passported entitlement, which is the severe disability addition to pension credit. So in our report, we recommended that information about short-term assistance and this potential issue could be included. In response, the government indicated that people should tell the Department for Work and Pensions that the date that their benefit has been reinstated, so that the relevant reserve benefit could be reassessed and any additions reinstated. We also understand that the Scottish Government believes that the outcome we've described doesn't occur in practice, and we are remaining in conversation with policy officials on this matter. It might also be useful to add that in relation to the technical amendments to short-term assistance, the recommendations we made for guidance to include more scenarios and to monitor short-term assistance were accepted.
Much, Marlene. I believe Adam would like to come in quickly on that, and then I'm going to move on to the next theme. Thanks.
We'll be very quick. I was actually going back to the original point of the amidst the glaringly obvious part, the benefit is the name, and making it simplifying the language. One of the challenges and the barriers to these things is calling something attendance allowance. No one knows what that means. You know, the word in itself would feel like, is this to pay for a care or a care? The allowance is this kind of like handed to you kind of thing, whereas actually the change of name is much more simple. And I think that could certainly be beneficial to people claiming what they're entitled to and understanding more about what it is, as opposed to being some really abstract concept. And I think this is really positive in terms of how Scotland's looking at the devolution and where name changes are appropriate and possible.
Okay, thanks very much. So moving on to theme four, which is the differences between ADP and CDP. I'm going to invite Bob Doris in now, thanks.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, one of the differences would appear to be with child disability payment, the opportunity was taken to be a bit more consistent in relation to how renal dialysis was deemed to qualify for the higher rate or the lower rate of disability payment. So if the renal dialysis happened daytime and at night, you could qualify for the higher rate. That opportunity has not been taken by the Scottish Government with these regulations, but the Scottish Government has said it could draw in guidance to clarify some of that, which might improve outcomes, if I've understood this correctly. So perhaps Marilyn Howard, I suspect, has had a considered view from Scots in relation to this. Discuss think that the relying on guidance will be sufficient.
Thank you. Yes, I think the issue comes back to aligning attendance allowance and pension age disability payment during case transfer. So our report did indicate that the development of pension age disability payment was an opportunity to reconsider. And the Scottish Government has indicated that guidance could be produced so that decision makers could take a more holistic view of someone's situation. So we think that is a reasonable approach for now.
So can I just, from my own understanding, Marilyn, currently if there's renal dialysis, then you're pretty much automatically going to get the lower rate for pensioners disability payments. However, the devil will be the detail of the guidance in relation to whether, if there's nighttime dialysis, whether you'll get the higher rate. Have I understood that correctly, and SCOS is content with that approach?
My understanding is that guidance should cover all of those issues. I think we have, in our first recommendation, we did suggest that the government should review the pension age disability payment as a whole, in line with the principles, once these case transfer has completed. Okay. So we would hope that this would be one of the issues, along with the other ones that have been raised, which would be part of a review in the longer term.
That's helpful, but guidance for the moment, but part of a review for the longer term, perhaps. I was going to move on to another question for what other witnesses, but before I do, does Adam or Debbie want to add anything to that particular aspect? Okay, thank you. So the Scottish Government will not shorten the six-month qualifying period for pensioners' disability payment, as this would lead to people, as they put it, with very short-term conditions becoming eligible. They also refer to the cost, and coincidentally, it's roughly £20 million. That was not deliberate from my earlier question, I do apologise. It's roughly about £20 million, and the risk of passported benefits being compromised. What are the witnesses' views of this, in particular of the justifications? Maybe Debbie Horne, I could take you in first.
Yes, thank you, Deputy Convener. At Independent Age, we do believe that the qualifying period should be shortened. So currently it's kind of 6 months. For child disability payment and adult disability payment, it's 3 months or 13 weeks. In terms of the Scottish Government's justification, it's very difficult to know if that change would result in people with short-term conditions applying for the payment. The current evidence that we've seen doesn't seem to indicate that. So, for example, if you look at the current top five conditions and reasons why people are receiving attendance allowance, they're arthritis, dementia, heart disease, chest disease, so all sort of long-term conditions. And we know that roughly around 40% of those on attendance allowance have been receiving the payment for more than 5 years. So it's obviously very difficult to predict, but it would be helpful to have more clarity from the Scottish Government on why they kind of believe that change would result in more people with short-term conditions receiving the payment. And there is that, obviously, that ongoing entitlement, and that if there was a change in circumstances, people would need to report that if they were no longer kind of eligible and needing that, meeting that threshold of requiring that care or supervision. In terms of the cost, it goes back to our earlier discussions. Obviously, budget decisions are decisions for the Scottish Government to make. We have heard from older people who have been in financial hardship and really struggling in that 6 months waiting period. So I know one older lady we spoke to who had been diagnosed with a very serious long-term condition, and she had been told by the council welfare rights advisor, you need to live with this for 6 months before you can get any help. So I think it's about, with those principles of continuous improvement in mind, thinking about, is there something we can do to enable people to get support that bit earlier, rather than having to wait 6 months after a potentially life-changing diagnosis to be able to claim
payment? Just before I bring Mr Stacoura in, my understanding was with the reforms to the child's disability payment, it's not a clear 3 months, it's 3 months with an expectation the condition will endure for a further 9 months. Does that cast a bit more doubt in relation to the Scottish Government's cost assumptions around £21 million, perhaps?
It's difficult to say. So for both child and adult disability payment, there is, you have to have been living with them, the kind of impact of the condition for the 3 months prior, and then there is an expectation, I'm certain, of kind of you will still be experiencing that condition for the next 9 months, whereas that provision does not exist in pension age disability payment. It's purely based on you having experienced the condition for the previous 6 months. So there is that difference between how the rules are set out in pension age disability payment compared to child and adult disability payment.
That's helpful. I'm just wondering, I will bring in Mr. Sakura, if the way to do this would be to get that safe and secure transition that we keep talking about, the transfer of cases over, and then Marilyn Howard was talking about looking at it afresh. Is this one of the things you'd like the government to look at afresh once that transfer has happened?
Yes, it's something that we believe the Scottish Government could have done at the point of transition, as it's only affecting sort of new claims. So the people who are being transferred over from the current DWP system, they already have eligibility, so they won't be affected by that sort of rule. So it could have been introduced at the point of creation, but it's definitely something we would want to see as part of that longer-term review.
OK, that's helpful. Adam Sakura?
I agree with everything there. I think the criteria and the time frame is important if you're looking at older people as well, is that the likelihood that someone's going to recover from some of the conditions that might make them eligible for attendance allowance can be quite low, but living for a longer period of time with any extra added support could actually worsen conditions and actually cause further challenges later on as well. So if someone's just advice to maybe give somebody to live with a condition for 6 months and actually maybe not be able to put the mitigating factors such as some financial support to pay for physio or other things as well, actually could find themselves in a tough position after that. So big opportunity to rationalise across all the criteria in Scotland, and wonder whether the reason for doing that is just because of the pot of money that exists just now and not enough research on the impact of any changes yet.
Without wanting to put words into your mouth, Mr. Sakura, would some conditions be self-evident that they're going to endure for a long period of time rather than having to wait 6 months to qualify?
Yeah, certainly. Yeah.
I have put words into your mouth, so I apologise. I don't know if Marilyn Howard's got anything to add, but I've got no further questions. Marilyn, do you want any observations on that?
Yes. excuse me. just to add that we did get information from Alzheimer's Scotland, and they told us that the qualifying period could disadvantage a small number of people who need to make a claim because of needs arising from an acute or sudden onset of illness or injury, and someone in that position would have to wait for 6 months. So the qualifying period is one of the issues which we think could be considered as part of future changes.
Thank you. Thank you, Kira.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite John Mason in.
Thanks so much, convener. Really following on from Bob Dorris, have the panel any other suggestions as to what could be made to bring the three, the child disability payment, adult disability payment and pension age disability payment, more into line with each other? I mean, the names, I agree with Mr. Sakura that is useful to have the names all the same, but I mean, that in itself can make people think, the rules will all be the same. Have you any other suggestions as to how things might improve?
I'm very honest, I'm not in the weeds of all the detail around child disability payment, and I've been more focused on the older age elements, and because most of them have always been or have been reserved and are now moving across, I don't have too much to add there, but there are certainly things about, of course, the name, the making sure that the process for applying is consistent across all of them. There might be wrinkles as things move over to work out if something's been more established in Scotland and the learnings that Social Security Scotland have had from them in terms of routes or applications or assessments. But I think that's going to be, you'll find more once it happens for this one.
Okay, well, that's fair enough. I'll come to Ms. Howard at the end because she's the one with the oversight probably of everything. Ms. Horne, did you have anything else on that?
Just very briefly, the points raised previously around the mobility component and bringing the qualifying period into line with adult and child disability payment.
Yes. Am I getting the impression that, in a sense, looking forward is more important than looking back? Was that your point, that if something sudden happens to you, it's the future that matters more than how long you've had it?
Yes. If somebody is diagnosed with a kind of life-altering condition, then from that moment, the support they get going forward is really what matters.
Okay, thanks. And Ms. Howard, you've got oversight of all three. Should they be more consistent?
Yes, we do. Certainly there's a case to look at benefits over time, but I don't think we have any more specific comments to add at this stage.
That's great. Thanks so much. Convener.
OK. Very quickly, moving on to theme five, but before I do that, I'm going to bring in Jeremy Balfour very quickly. Thank you.
Yeah, just very quickly. Obviously, the criteria for getting the award between adult disciplinary and the new benefit is different. We don't have the same descriptors that we have, and it's more about the average day in someone's life. Is that the best way to go forward, or would you like to see the descriptors which we have for ADP brought in, maybe not immediately, but over time? Or do you have any view? You maybe not have a view on that at all. Well, maybe Ms. Howard, and then either the other two.
Thank you. I don't think we have a view on that at this particular point in time, no.
No, there's nothing obvious for me.
No. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. So, moving on to theme five, which is improving take-up, I'm going to invite Marie McNair in. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Adam, you kind of rightly pointed out earlier, obviously 54 years have passed and no change has been made to attendance allowance. Are you aware of kind of any reasons why the Westminster government haven't put forward any reason for leaving it unreformed for so long?
Don't have any obvious reason, to be honest. I think some of this is all about political will. And we've had, since then, how many governments have we had? UK government, and there's been different things that have been a priority. And I've been very honest, there's lots of things that impact older people that are not often a political priority to change. There's also parts of this that probably work pretty well once you've got it. And once you've got through the system, you've jumped through all the fiery hoops that you're there, you're receiving that kind of weekly payment to support you, that it has been deemed as broadly successful. It's the folks that aren't getting anywhere near it, don't know that it exists, are put off by application processes, that have been turned down or will never apply again. But I think there is certainly an element around the politics of older people's issues and maybe not necessarily getting all the focus, or indeed some of it probably being quite good.
Thanks, Adam. Thanks for that. Debbie, the Scottish Fiscal Commission are estimating more costs because of the increased take-up, and that's welcome. And obviously, given some of your comments earlier, what more should the Scottish Social Security do and the Scottish Government do to encourage take-up of pension age disability payment?
Yes, thank you for the question. So the creation of a pension age disability payment, it really does bring about an opportunity to increase awareness and to boost take-up. So we know from research that we've done that around 13% of older disabled people aren't aware of attendance allowance. So there's a real opportunity to make sure through kind of public awareness that people are aware of the payment, what it's there for, and being really clear on that it is a right for people to be able to receive, that challenge and the stigma around it. Because we've also found that around 5% of older disabled people who are aware of attendance allowance haven't claimed because they don't want to be seen as claiming a benefit. Mm-hmm. And this is the self and kind of entrenched stigma that comes from the kind of media and culture that we sometimes have when we're talking about social security, that people, even when they're in a position where they could really use the extra money, won't claim. So it's really important to get that language and tone right. There's that awareness piece. Once people are aware of the payment, they also need to be able to apply for the payment in an easy and accessible way. So making sure that those home visits through Social Security Scotland are available, the presence of local delivery offices, that is easy for people to get those application forms and to access the support to complete the form. Because we know around 6% of people do need have been unable to claim attendance allowance previously because they lacked that support. So it's that raising awareness and ensuring that the application process, it's sort of getting the basics right for many people, will really help to drive take-up. We're also keen to see the Scottish Government relook at the benefit take-up strategy and to think more about what can be done for older people and pension age disability payment within that. And just to expand on an earlier point around what action local authorities can take to improve take-up, at Independent Age, we published a benefit take-up toolkit for local authorities last year, and this was based on examples of local authorities across the UK that had done great work to improve take-up, one being Glasgow City Council, who had a memorandum of understanding with the DWP, were able to get data on all the attendance allowance claimants within Glasgow, and they then matched it with data the council had to identify all of the households in Glasgow who were older, who were not receiving attendance allowance, and they were then able to contact those older people to arrange for appointments with welfare rights advisers. And over 14 months, the first 14 months of that project, increased the incomes of older people in Glasgow by over £2 million. So there's that kind of mix of making sure that the pension age disability payment system is known about, that it's simple, that it's easy for people to access, and then also doing that targeted outreach. I think those are two key parts of that picture to really boost in.
Yeah, there's some really good work happening in Glasgow just now. Just to follow on, what else do you think, obviously you've touched a bit, but what else can we do to kind of further simplify the process and streamline it?
Yes, so I think making sure that the application form for pension age disability payment is as simple as possible is going to be really vital. So at the minute, as I said earlier, it's around a 30-page application form, kind of over 60 questions. We've heard from older people who in their professional lives have done jobs where they've dealt with complex data, writing papers, and they've told us that writing this form was a horrendous experience. It stripped me of my dignity. I remember one lady telling me that she has tremors, and by the time she was halfway through completing the form, she had to stop because her tremors were so bad, as she found it so kind of emotionally upsetting. It was having that physical effect. So I think getting that form right is so important, and then making sure that those decisions are made right as well first time is really vital for older people.
Thank you for that. Debbie, Adam, do you want to kind of share some thoughts?
Yeah, thank you. There's opportunity in all of this about how our public services communicate with citizens, and we have lots of missed opportunities when we look at this. If you look at where benefits are, Social Security, and this, why the language is important, not necessarily talking about benefits, but Social Security or entitlements can be much more important, is when, for instance, Social Security Scotland are writing out to people when they'll be receiving, when the devolved, winter fuel payment comes in, for instance, would you also advertise pension age disability payment? If you've been receiving the devolved version of the cold weather payment, would you also write about the, so kind of cross-referring to actually know who people are and where they are, ensuring that there is a good amount of promotion of this as not just online, that it's in paper form, that it's kind of, direct to people, because we've got hundreds of thousands of older people who are not online. And if you're lower income or you're disabled, you're more likely not to be online. So sticking something on a website somewhere does not equal good and effective promotion. And using the data that we have, I think, is incredibly important. Local authorities, when they're putting out, their annual council tax letters, what more information could actually go into that, since you're writing to every single household in your area. These things obviously have costs, but you will see improved outcomes if benefits uptake is improved.
Thank you. Don't really want to leave Marion out. Obviously, I thought my questions were best directed to Adam and Debbie, but anything you'd like to share before I move back to the convener?
Yes, thank you. I would only add that in relation to take-up, we heard from stakeholders like Citizens Advice and Alzheimer's Scotland that communications could be targeted at health and social care professionals and at specific groups of older people, such as those with mental health and cognitive impairments, or from minority ethnic communities. I would maybe just finally add that as part of our function to report on charter expectations, we are embarking on some initial research to consider the experiences of disabled people with communication needs who access Social Security Scotland services. So we'll obviously be updating the committee on that piece of work as it progresses further.
Many thanks for that, Marilyn. Back to yourself, convener.
Okay, thanks very much. And that concludes all of our questions. So thank you all for attending our meeting today. The committee will reflect on the evidence heard, and we'll hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice next week when we consider the affirmative instrument as well. So this concludes our public business for today, and we'll now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. So thank you very much.